a student.
There was the academic atmosphere, which was one thing, and then there was the social atmosphere, the way that we lived. Well, social atmosphere is very amusing to describe it to students nowadays. There was some effort to make the Smith girls into ladies. The various dormitories, which are always at Smith called houses, each had a house mother. It was the house mother's duty to enforce certain rules and regulations, also to keep up certain standards of gentility. There were dress codes. You had to wear skirts or dresses for dinner. And then coffee served in the living room after dinner in demitasses. There were also lots of protocol about receiving male guests. No man, not your brother or father, was ordinarily allowed above the first floor.
When Sylvia Plath was at Smith College, she won a guest editorship to Mademoiselle. The magazine brought her and a number of other girls to New York in the summer of 1953. You can see why Mademoiselle precipitated the kind of breakdown that it did. All of the kinds of tensions in the culture that were in the back of her life as an American girl at that time must surely have come to a head and been almost dramatized, theatricalized during the Mademoiselle experience.
Now, I had a letter from Sylvia from New York. This was just before she came home. And she said, "You'll never want to see me again, Mr. Crockett. I have let you down." And I puzzled over the letter. I couldn't realize that she was at a rope's end. And I was vacationing in New Hampshire when news of her disappearance came. There was a great deal of attention at the time. The New York Times had a long account of Smith, well-known Smith girl, you know, disappearing. Finally, of course, she was found in her home after a period of 2 or 3 days.
She came home and that was when she had her breakdown. She couldn't concentrate. She couldn't read. She just wasn't the same girl that went. And that's when she started, well, the only thing she read was Freud's Abnormal Psychology and found all sorts of symptoms that she was sure applied to her and felt that she'd be a burden to the family the rest of her life. And couldn't go back and take up her studies at Smith. She just felt she couldn't read or do anything. And when she came to consciousness after her first attempt, the first thing she said, "That was my last act of love." There were two words that she used a great deal. One was always and the other was never. Thing was either always or it was never. Everything was magnified. I never knew anyone to reach the heights of joy that she reached at times, nor the depths of absolute despair. Ricocheted.
The suicide attempt was hugely important. She had periods of chronic, more or less psychotic depression. But she also had huge energy, immense kind of fight and drive and energy. The suicide, to some extent, was linked with a kind of arrogance. Lady Lazarus is about, "I can get through this too. You think you've got me, you haven't got me. Rising from the dead, and I eat men like air." It's a kind of angry poem. It's a declaration of war. She wasn't a kind of passive victim in any conceivable way. She was one tough cookie.
Lady Lazarus, I have done it again. 1 year in every 10, I manage it. A sort of walking miracle. My skin bright as a Nazi lampshade. My right foot a paperweight. My face a featureless fine Jew linen. The first time it happened, I was 10. It was an accident. The second time I meant to last it out and not come back at all. I rocked shut as a seashell. They had to call and call and pick the worms off me like sticky pearls. Dying is an art, like everything else. I do it exceptionally well. I do it so it feels like hell. I do it so it feels real. I guess you could say I've a call.
She talked about suicide as something that she had once had a go at. And it was as if she had once played tournament tennis or something like that. Something that Sylvia had done. And she loved to show her scars and tell the story of her smashing on the basement floor, whatever it was. And how life force in her, she said, the life force in her was so strong that it counteracted all those pills she'd eaten. And up Sylvia popped.
Sylvia won a Fulbright scholarship to study English at Newnham College in Cambridge, England, in 1955. That, as much as anything, probably helped her recover from the nervous breakdown. She threw herself into student life, and among other things, she was active in the Footlights, the Cambridge Amateur Dramatic Society.
She must have been rather lost at Cambridge. I should think Sylvia was astonished to discover the difference between a woman's college in the States and a woman's college in Cambridge University. Utterly astonished. Whoever she was, how often she was published, got herself done up as a model for some magazine. It wouldn't have meant anything. They don't have stars at Oxford or Cambridge.
One of the things that I think I like most about the English is their ability to be eccentric, to be themselves to such an extent that they're strikingly different from anybody else.
The most important thing at Cambridge was her further study in modernism and her readings of particularly Woolf and Yeats. She says in her journal when she's at Cambridge that Virginia Woolf makes my work possible. Then she's also, of course, rather rivalrous and says, but I will do better than she did. Even during the Cambridge experience, she continued to be divided between a kind of deep commitment to intellectual, academic, aesthetic activity, and on the other hand, an urge toward being the popular all-American Fulbright scholar abroad. A story that was published in the Cambridge newspaper with the headline, Sylvia Plath tours the stores and models new spring fashions. There are amazing pictures of Plath modeling a bathing suit on the front cover of this Cambridge newspaper. And she sent a copy of the newspaper to her mother with the inscription, with love from Betty Grable. So it's the same tension. Does she want to be Virginia Woolf? Does she want to be a female reincarnation of William Butler Yeats? Or does she want to be Betty Grable?
In February of 1956, she met Ted Hughes. The tales that she tells in her journal are quite splendid about meeting and biting the great English genius, and then fell in love with the man. But one knows perfectly well, if Ted Hughes had been Ted Hughes and hadn't written poetry, I don't think it would have been the same story at all. He had to be important.
Ted Hughes had enormous influence on her work because he also was, in a very Laurentian way, looking at the underside of life, was dealing with the big, dark feelings.
I'd never be writing as I am and as much as I am without Ted's understanding and cooperation, really. All the poems that we wrote to each other and about each other were really before our marriage, and then something happened. I don't know what it was. I hope it was all to the good, but we began to be able to, well, somehow free ourselves for other subjects.
He taught her. He helped her find her own voice. I think that's very important. And I'm sure that, you know, were she alive today, and even if they were not still together, she would be the first to admit that.
Ted's interest in animals made me look back into my own life. And my father, among other things, was a biologist and happened to keep bees. And I didn't think much about this at the time, but I've become very interested in beekeeping, and the image of beekeeping has become part of my poems. And I think this is a direct result of knowing Ted. I somehow know more about my own past through him than I would otherwise.
The bee poems are a mythologized way of dealing with the relationship with the father, who was an expert in bees, the author of a book called Bumblebees and Their Ways. Also a way of coming to terms with issues having